Nice. Okay, I'm back at Licklibrary HQ today. Absolute pleasure to be back here. Currently, I'm filming a new classic album course, and it's to do with Fleetwood Mac. And that inspired me today to maybe talk about four simple things we can do to make our playing more expensive sounding. But first of all, I just want to check in on the chat. Hope everyone is doing well. Thank you for tuning in. Will, good fellow, happy Easter. Thank you. Happy Easter also to everybody here. John, good to see you. Timothy. I also saw some names appearing earlier in the chat. I can't remember everybody at once, but it's good to see you. It's nice to be back. And as always, you know, open to questions and answers throughout this session to make it of use to you and people also viewing this back later on. So I was actually playing along there to a jam track, a new jam track on the Licklibrary website. It's one of Nick Jennison's video jams. We'll look at that a bit later on. But that was a Fleetwood Mac style backing track. I wonder if people can sort of get the references to what song that's based upon. But it's a great place to test out some of these things. And of course, doing some Lindsey Buckingham stuff today. He is a master of, you know, doing more with less and doing a lot with less. Not necessarily playing spaciously, but doing lots of really emotive things. So let's break this down. Four ways to make your playing sound more expensive, your soloing sound more expensive. So I've written down sort of four things that I think are quite interesting, but with a precursor of one main thing. So the four topics are going to be articulation, dynamics, harmony, and rhythm and repetition. But before all of that, before we even set the stage of any of that stuff, we need to look at the context that we're playing within. And that can mean you have context in terms of, I sort of see two axes. You've got time in terms of how long you've got to say something. Is it 4, 8, 16, 32, 64 bars of music? How long is your solo going to be? And also the context in terms of kind of like the vertical context. I've had a long day. Having the other axes there, and that's about tone and how you're playing and how you want to sound. Now, I'm playing with a particularly kind of low gain tone for this. I want something that's quite expressive so that I can get more out of my guitar pick, out of the guitar itself. However, before we did this live stream, I was having an awesome jam with Kim, who runs Licklibrary, and we were using a different patch on the quad cortex, and we were using like a Victory Kraken style amp, high gain. And it worked still in that context, but we had a bit more of a warmer tone with the high gain thing. So it's kind of down to you to really listen to that and be aware of that. Try not to just play with the tone that you have all the time, just, you know, preset. You know, listen and see if it's actually helping you, because sometimes it can get in the way. It depends. So there we are. So here's my tone. I've just got, this is the tone I was just playing with on the bridge pickup. You know, I wanted a bit of ambience to it. I sort of see reverb and delay as kind of like a way of sustaining lower gain tones, because it gives you, my friend, my great guitarist called Lewis Harding, who I'm from where I live, I think he said it's like the memory of a note. You know, it kind of gives you that note more size if you have a bit of reverb and delay on. So it allows you to linger on notes. Which is quite nice. And I've got a bit of overdrive on there as well, so when I dig in, you know, I can go there if I want to. So that's the first thing, that's where I've gone. I want it not to be too trebly, not too harsh, but that's the vibe. So for this session, we're going to start with articulations, and I want to sort of imagine this track's an A minor. We won't play the track for the moment. Let's just pretend we had an arbitrary melody, okay? So this. That's the melodic fragment. So stepwise and simple. I've got C, D, E. That could be anything, it could mean anything depending on the chord underneath it. So I've got 5, 7, and 8 on the 9 on the G. Now already I'm playing it different ways. You could play it this way. I could pick, you know, if I was a MIDI guitar player, all the notes, same volume, all the same picking, evenly spaced, one and two. And all of this is so obvious, what I'm about to tell you, and you're all brilliant guitar players, you'll have loads of potential. You don't need me to tell you this, but sometimes it's helpful to just remember this, and this is really for myself to remember. So whenever you see me teaching something, it's because I'm needing to practice it myself. So keep that in mind. But as we go through those notes, like that was a good one. Straight away, that means something different. I've gone pick. And then I put in a little kind of quick, I call them ghost notes on guitar. You know, it's basically we're playing 5, 7 and 9, but I'm giving myself a hammer on. And I'm also using that hammer on as a moment to dig in, it seems. That seems to happen in the same. Now clearly at some point when I've been transcribing a guitar player or a favorite solo, I've picked up that mini technique where that becomes natural. And the reason why I'm saying all this stuff is obvious and sometimes we need to remember is that sometimes we forget about all the options we have with all those kind of licks that we end up playing all the time. You know, we just end up playing. You know, we just go into default. So how can I change that? So I could stop, I could get some staccato into that line. So stopping the note. I could do it all legato. I wonder if I can get that little hammer on going. So pick hammer, pick hammer. Okay. And the next thing to do is, you know, we can work with all just one finger slides. Or I could try open strings. Now we're starting to get into some more interesting territory. We're starting to venture outside of where we physically are on the fretboard. Another thing to consider, listen to the difference there. I'm just on the bridge pickup, so on the G. Now I'm on the A string playing the exact same unison notes. Maybe I won't do that there because my intonation's a bit funny. There's so much different tonal options right there. And then to then bring in our friend, the guitar pick. Now the guitar pick isn't there just to, you know, be like a, I don't know, like a toothbrush or something in between us and our teeth. It's not like it's a tool, but it also shapes our sound, okay? So maybe. I could even. So many different things you can do with that, and that changes how it sounds. Now, it's so obvious, but that's often the thing that inspires us to do our next phrase, play our next phrase, search for a new idea. If we're in automatic, we can do lots of great things probably, but it's not as real, not as alive when you're not kind of responding and actually playing to the sound of what you just played. That actually helps you say the next thing. It's like a conversation. If someone asks you where the bus stop is, you don't start talking about central heating or something. You'll say, the nearest bus stop is actually just down the road on the left. So it's all context, right? So you're actually being alive to the context. Now, we often play guitar like that conversation. Where's the nearest bus stop? Oh, the radiator. Oh, that's a light over there. I wonder what type of bulb that is. Oh, and the carpet. I need to get a new carpet. So we end up kind of just going off on a train of thought rather than the context of the music. So I think if someone's written a blues summerlins, use a slide maybe. A slide would be a fantastic option. I don't have a slide on me at the moment, but how do we emulate a slide? Here's another one. So one thing we can do is maybe look at ways of articulating that, which maybe I'll bend 7 to 9 there, and I'll use that bend as a way to get slide-like vibrato on that 9th fret note, on the note E. Now that's a different type of vibrato, because we can actually go down and above the note, rather than when we just... That vibrato is always going to be up. Now, again, super obvious point, right? But here we go. We want to, you know, if we're always hearing ourselves do the same vibrato, we're always going to do the same thing. It's like habits. You know, you might, you get like a memory of a smell or a sight, and it takes you back to a certain memory. Well, it's the same with our vibrato and all the stuff we play. If we're finding ourselves playing those same old licks all the time and going automatic, it's because probably these subtle things are kind of triggers that lead us onto the next phrase that we're probably going to play. And this isn't bad, but if we're looking to make us playing sound more countable, more expensive, then that's quite an interesting point. Again, another thing that I've been playing with, and because I've been doing this Fleetwood Mac stuff, just playing with your thumb and fingers, it really takes you off into a different instant expense. You could roll your tone back. I bring my hand actually over the strings a bit more, over the neck, sorry. Now I'm playing lines there that if I have the pick, I'm going to default to things I do with the pick, but as soon as I bring my hand on the guitar, I'm more likely to grab things in a completely different way. So that's something I'm really enjoying in my own playing. So next thing is to really kind of switch it up, how you play. Okay, cool. So we've talked about a little bit about articulations. That's one thing you can do. And that for me, I'm sort of saying, you know, if you have those three notes, how many different ways can you articulate those notes within the same rhythm, within the same register? That's something to try. Again, another thing, one final thing actually here is placement. So those notes, C, D, E, we can play C, D, E, we can play C, D, play it there. You know, we can actually grab this in so many different ways that it might lead to different options. Semitone bend into each of them. That might be something that changes up where you go. Also, physically, if I'm actually playing that melody, you know, I could go. It might inspire a different ending, that kind of thing. Again, the next thing, of course, really obvious, and this to me is, I think technique and tone and dynamics, they all fit together, really. And this is why I've been mindful of actually the techniques you use rather than just kind of treating them as, you know, this is a bulldozer and I just pick everything all the time. This is actually a tone control instead. Then you can start to lead things in different places. So for example, the obvious one is, I'm playing this in a certain way. Sorry, I know this melody might be kind of grating on people's ears a little bit. So, but how do we make that a bit more interesting? We could, you know, quiet and into loud, super staccato, or vibrato. Do I need to put vibrato on? There's a lot you can do there. Maybe going around the note. You know, using some legato. Or maybe even, now we're starting to get into line development, you see. So rather than just seeing that one very simple idea, it's starts to become. We can start doing more scalic stuff around it. Now already I'm getting loads of ideas and keeping to that one theme, so it's not like I'm just kind of going around the street talking random subjects at people. I've taken my theme and now we're literally exploring it, we're lingering on it. And I think half the battle with improvisation, I think Bobby McFerrin, I was being on a bit of a Bobby McFerrin binge recently. He's that guy who did the Don't Worry, Be Happy song, and he does all the vocal stuff. And he said, you know, the trick to improvisation is to keep going, you know, in terms of keeping you, to develop your confidence, to actually kind of keep a train of thought going without kind of jumping around randomly. Like actually, you know, are your phrases making sense? Are they linking up in some way? Or when you do change phrase, is it you're doing something for dramatic effect rather than because you're just going somewhere else on the fretboard because you can? And there's nothing wrong with that. But if you listen to great sort of improvisers who are quote unquote tasty guitar players, Matthias Lasato, John Mayer, insert your favorite name, you know, in the comments, they're not just jumping around. They're really sort of following their ideas through. Okay. So the next thing to think about is harmony. You know, these are just one note. We're in the key of A minor, C major. So we have those seven diatonic notes there, literally A, B, C, D, E, F, G, A. Now we can harmonize. We can do that in thirds. We could actually have a, you know, from there, or we could actually put a third above. We could put sixths. We could do sevenths. What else could we do? Fourths. They all lead to completely different things, you know. So this is to practice this, and this is why I kind of I think my students get a bit annoyed at me sometimes, because I'm always like, if you're going to practice your fretboard, learn your scales with your intervals. You know, can you play a scale in thirds? Can you do it in harmonic thirds, meaning grabbing at the same time and also melodically separately? Fourths, fifths, we've got sixths, sevenths, even octaves are an interval. I mean, even that, you want to go sort of Vi, sort of Eric Johnson-esque. You've got to mix those octaves, those sixths and fourths and fifths. And if you're not too up on your theory, then I recommend learning about this stuff, about intervals. We know a lot about our guitar pedals and things, but do we know our neck? Do we know the harmony? Can we hear that stuff? But another way of looking at this, and this is, if I'm honest with you, this is the way I came up with this stuff, is just looking at the geometric pattern and looking for double stops. That could be nice, and use your ear to find those things. Maybe harmonize a chord. You know, what chord voicings, diatonic. We've got A minor, all these fifth rooted chords. Can we harmonize as we go along? he says as he doesn't be able to do it. I'm just searching for things that can ring out together. But that one basic melody has now become doing you know, kind of constant stream of thought. Okay, and then finally, repetition. And not being afraid to repeat. I think that's one thing I'm enjoying seeing and hearing in players, is when they're not afraid to repeat an idea. Now, part of what's jarring about this phrase probably by now is I'm playing it with the same rhythm. I'm going duh, duh, duh. But I could, you know, depending on the context, I could syncopate it. I could, when I repeat it, I could. There's so much music already in there, and I'm not thinking about playing other scale patterns, not even thinking about the harmony necessarily, but giving myself a limitation of a place and then doing something rhythmically with it is really important. And Mike, I've just seen, left a long comment there about Julian Large, who's an amazing guitar player. And he recommends recording 10 one-minute improvs with a beginning, middle, and end 6 days a week, then take the time to review them for the strengths and weaknesses of the seventh day. Yeah, that reminds me of also what Wayne Krantz also recommends, but also giving yourself phrase lengths as well, 2, 4, and 8 bar chunks. And here's the next thing, really, like apart from repetition, you know, when you're improvising a solo, I keep on saying this, and I've said this in other live streams, don't just meander over the backing track, give yourself phrase lengths, because realistically in music, you're going to be playing a verse, a chorus, a pre-chorus. You're not going to be playing endless solos, and even the endless solos are structured in some ways, even if they're improvised. So an example of that, let's put on this backing track quickly. In fact, I just want to just point to this. Let's take a moment to refresh our ears a bit. I just want to look at the website quickly. On Lick Library, if we go over, if you're a member, you can go to the backing track section and there's video jams. And if you click on there, you get these great jam tracks with Nick Jennison, who's put them together, the amazing Nick Jennison. And I'm just going to play you a bit just so you can see, but he's put scale diagrams and chord progressions on there. And he's also, you can see him playing the rhythm. Let's have a take a look at that. So I'm just going to move it along. So you can see our scale positions there. You can see Nick playing his taking phrases. He's got a chord progression. Now what I recommend is you can actually see A minor. F major 2, 3, 4, C, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, 4, 2, 3, 4. So just to come back to the guitar for a moment, we're actually focusing on phrase lengths. You're not just soloing for whatever. Let's just go back a bit. I'm going to improvise over that, and I'm going to improvise. I'll change my idea that I'm basing my improvising around every 4 bars. We'll see what happens. We'll see if the track lets us do that. Okay. 2. Nope. New head. Okay. It's going to come in. Here we go. Idea. Back to the first idea. Moving up now. Maybe I'll keep that rhythm. Okay. Next idea. So we're kind of bringing back the other idea, but just in a different octave. Now into another section. It's hard to sort of teach and talk and improvise at the same time, and so please don't judge the ideas too closely there, but hopefully you could hear at least it was kind of funneling my thinking. So the Julian Large thing and the Wayne Krantz thing of kind of structuring your improvisations, practicing that way, and exactly listening back and seeing what you're doing. I never listen, I try not to anyway, to any of these live streams. But in my own practice, just putting on a bit of recording and kind of analysing that. And most of the time, actually, it's stopping doing stuff. One thing that we're all guilty of is just going off on a rant like I'm doing now. You know, it's easy to, especially if we practice guitar a lot in terms of technique, we've got our scales down, we've got some licks and things like that. We can play a lot of stuff, but we never pause or we never develop ideas. So repetition and rhythm and timing and context is all going to really really help you kind of focus your improvisations. And that is one of the tricks to making yourself sound expensive. So I really appreciate Mike's question, because you know, you're going to listen back to your playing and you're going to instantly hear what makes you, you know, what you like, what you don't like. And at the end of the day, it's your playing. So you being able to sort of audit your playing a little bit and not get too harsh about it. That's one big thing there. Don't get too harsh. Just be objective and like, I don't like the sound of that thing. I might, or you, one thing for me, you know, rushing certain licks or going over the bar line a bit too much for my personal tastes or whatever, kind of finishing phrases and kind of awkward places, might be just a simple thing to fix by just saying, oh, I'm going to now spend my next 10 minutes practicing working on intervals, or I might improvise, you know, 9/8 note, you know, long phrases, maybe 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, I'm always landing on the root. Maybe I'll land on the 9 now. A minor third. Oops, a bit early there. So kind of deliberately, you know, using these, your improvisation to kind of fine tune those things. And eventually, in real life, forget all this stuff and just play. But I think this can be all summarized with just listen and be curious about what the phrases you're playing do. One exercise I do with students, if I have like 10 students, we'll do 2 bars of improv on a phrase. So there's only 2 bars. 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4. And then 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4. 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 2, 3. That's another one. Not always sort of finishing your sentences. You know, finish your sentence deliberately, but don't just finish it on. It's kind of when I'm playing about context. I want to sometimes hear the root note, but you know, landing on a 4 over the chord. It's like, oh. That's, you know, I'm not thinking necessarily too much about that, but that can be helpful, especially if you find yourself kind of thinking, oh, that's you've said everything, it's done. But actually those tension notes, they can be useful for creating, you know, momentum in your solo, because you have that kind of contrast of, you know, question, answer, or build up and result, you know, all that kind of stuff. Yeah, cool. So I don't know if there's any questions about that. Just to summarize that, I can JM Guitar Tuition says, one exercise I do with my students is 2 bars on, 2 bars off. Basically, you learn your lick, then you give them 2 bars of rhythm. Yeah, that sounds very much like the exercise that I do with the students as well. So, and the 2 bar thing, I think, is great, because it kind of, you can't sort of sit there planning too much. You have to just respond, you know, and in real life situations, that's kind of how it is if you're improvising. And I think we say what we really mean when we don't overthink it, you know, we just go. And developing that skill and confidence to kind of come in with a good idea and stick with it, or even if you fluff the idea, how well can you keep that going without making it into a kind of, oh, I've messed that up, or kind of, you know, a search party, as I like to call it. You start to sort of, you know, just kind of go fishing for ideas. There's two modes of practice I think I'm sort of hearing myself get to here. You've got your, you know, in time having a bit of responsibility for your improvisation, and then there's also the searching improvisation, where you stick on one of these lovely video jam tracks and you just go and you see if you can keep yourself going. Like Bobby McFerrin says, just keep the momentum going. Both are going to feed each other, you know, because that momentum idea, you eventually get bored of what you're playing, so you'll search for new ideas. And then that kind of timed playing, 2, 4 and 8 bars, and focusing on looking for variations on things and sticking with an idea, using all these articulations, dynamics. We're using harmony and intervals as well to kind of maybe create chords around things. All that stuff is going to help you kind of develop things and be able to say things that you mean in the moment. So yeah, I think that's it. So I'm going to do some more improvisation now, see if I can apply some of those things. And if anybody has any questions, drop them in the comments. And if not, no worries. I hope this has been helpful. But let's have a little bit of a jam and we'll come back. 4-bar phrases. Coming in towards the end of this round, so really fun backing track to play over. Of course, when we bring things like changes and chord things in there, there's a bit more thinking to go. Although, you know, fairly simple changes on that, everything sounds kind of good to land on, so I don't need to worry too much. But then again, another thing you can do, of course, and I think the reason why I've avoided saying this one is it's so obvious, but having a mixture of pentatonics and arpeggios and knowing your intervallic kind of system as well, you can do all the superimposition stuff. You could limit yourself to playing a certain arpeggio superimposed over a different chord. You can think of all these kind of systems. They're kind of good maps to kind of help get you in a certain mindset, and definitely very useful tools to apply. But I think what I'm trying to give you here really is the simple things that you can do with what you've already got. And I think the message I want to give is that, you know, if you break just some habits slightly, as such as vibrato and all these kind of muscle memory things, then it might lead you to playing some new ideas that feel more satisfying. You don't need to learn 1,000 new licks necessarily. Whilst that is helpful, it's better to work with what you got and then dive into what makes you interested. Okay, cool. Well, I think that's about all the time we have. Thank you so much for tuning in. It's good to see you all. Thanks for the questions. And statements, really, some great things. JM Guitar Tuition, really appreciate your feedback, and also Mike as well with the Julian Large thing. Everyone should check out Julian Large and Wayne Krantz for that matter as well, both just terrifyingly expressive and beautiful musicians of improvisation and jazz. Happy Easter, everyone. Absolutely dead man. Helmet Strap, good to see you. Thank you so much for tuning in. I think we'll be back soon with more live streams. Of course, we've got Nick on Mondays as well, giving you some amazing advice and all kinds of things. It's great being here. Tomorrow, I'll be finishing off this Fleetwood Mac course, so I'm excited to do that. It's been a lot of notes, surprisingly, so it's been good. All right, have a fantastic evening. Enjoy your Easter weekend. I'm going to play us out with some chords, and I'll see you soon. Thank you very much.